Hi everybody and welcome to the channel. I am Richard. Today I'm going to put you up on a hill, give you a little crown on your head and make you a king. That's right, I'm going to show you Kinghill. This is a 1-2 player game where you portray as, well, the king, trying to build up your castle and defend your land. Train your peasants and make them into great warriors or mages. This is a really, really cool game. It's a quite strategic game where you need to place out your workers, gather the products you need, and also get the workers that you need to make this castle run smoothly. I'm going to show you the setup of this game. I'm going to show you an overview of the game and go through some of the rules. So let's just have a look at it. So this is the setup of the board. You should start with placing out the board in the middle of the playing area for both players to reach. Both players should get a player board looking like this. I will show you a close-up of this soon. You should take the unit deck, mix it up real good, take the top 5 cards and place them out on the market. Then you should take the outskirt offers, take 2 legendary buildings and mix them in with the green outskirt offers. Mix it up real good. Place new cards on the market. You should do the same with the blue outskirt offers. Take 2 legendary buildings and mix them into this deck. If you, during the game, draw a legendary building, the yellow ones, from one of these piles, it should be placed in this spot over here, not with the rest of the markets. Up here, we should place the action tiles, looking like this. These will grant us more actions as we move on in the game. There are 9 spots for the 9 action cards, and on 2 of them, up on the right, each player places 1 of their peasants on 1 of the cards. All the resources, stones, money, health tokens and gems should be placed next to the board. Out here we have the power tokens. These should be shuffled up and placed next to the power field. Next to the power cards we have the force cards. These are used when we draw power cards, so they should be placed near the power tokens. On the player boards, we need to take a little token representing our color and place it on number 14 on the castle's endurance. We place 2 peasants in the country yard, and on the moonstone forts, we take our little token looking like this and place it on number 0. We also need to mix up the spell cards and place it next to the board. Once this setup is done, we need to give each player 2 hero cards. The hero cards are the ones looking like this. We should mix them up really, really good. And then each player draws 2 of the cards. The rest of the cards will not be used during this game. If we look at the cards that we draw from the hero deck, we can see that there are a bunch of different stats. Up here is the name of the hero. Here is the ability of the hero. Down here you have the upgraded ability. You have the starting force down here. And here you have the starting castle endurance. Now, starting with the first players, we need to choose one of these cards and discard the other one, taking the ones we have chosen and placing them next to our character board. This one is discarded. Some of these heroes give you a starting bonus. This one have a starting bonus of 14 in castle endurance, and we all started at 14, so this one really gives us nothing. But it gives us +1 in the starting force of the moonstones. So instead of starting at 0, we actually start our moonstone force at 1. We are ready now to start playing the game. This game is played out during 2 different rounds. The first round is the action round. This is where you get to place your little peasants out on the board. picking actions that you want them to do. Maybe you want them to train, to gather, to explore, and so on and so on. But this is the first step. So the first player takes their little token with their peasant, this is the peasant, and places them on the action that they would like to do. I would like to gather some resources. Once I have placed out my little peasant, it's time for the next player to place out their peasant. And when we have no more peasants to do anymore, we will move into the next round. But first, let's go through what we can do. Every one of these spots is where you can place a worker. You can only place one worker at a time on these spots, unless there is a green diamond below. But on these ones, there's only red. I chose the mine action over here, which grants me these resources. If I had placed a miner on this spot right here, I would also have received a bonus. But so far, I only have a peasant. So now the turn goes over to the second player and he chooses this action. To get the first player token and also get one stone and one resource. So now we have played each one action. I managed to get some resources, he managed to get some resources, and also the first player token. So now it's the other player's turn again, and he would like to explore. But if you look at the symbol in the middle here, he can't, because he needs a ranger to do this action. Most of the actions are empty, meaning that you can place a peasant there, but some of them have symbols in the middle, meaning that you can only place these workers here. If the player would have been able to explore, he could use that action to pick up the top two unit cards from the unit deck. These will give you different benefits and also characters to use in fights. The different kind of resources in this game, like the gems or the money or the stones over here, are used to buy different kinds of upgrade, either units or castle parts. So this player needs to find another action to do. He chooses this one because he wants to get some coins. If you look next to the coins, there is a symbol, a plus one blank spot. This means that in the end of every round, there is placed another coin here. So the next time a player will take this action, they will get two plus the coin that is in this spot. So it's finally my turn again, and I want to do this action. This is the train action, meaning that I can place a peasant on any one of these spots and train them to become one of these trades up here. So if I, for example, would like to train my peasant to become a ranger, I would place my little token here, but then change it for the ranger token instead, leaving it here for the end of the round. The peasant token goes back to my personal supply. As you can see up here, you will also receive a one-time bonus when training your peasant. So I, for example, could choose between an explore card or
a force.
The miner would get some resources, the warrior would get some extra passive bonuses on castle attacks. Here you would get some resources or a spell card, and if you train to an assassin, you will be able to move that ranger directly into your country yard as an assassin. Now you can only train for one ability at a time, unless you train for the assassin, because the assassin, like I said, goes directly down to your country yard, leaving you this space open again. As you can see, there are a lot of different actions for you to take on the board. You can choose to gather more gems, for example, and if you have a mage, you again get a bonus. You can choose to steal from your opponent, but you would need to be an assassin. You can also choose to kill, but you would again need to be an assassin. Up here you can mine for more resources, as well as up here. Then we have the higher action. This is one of the actions where actually two peasants can be on, because it has the green diamond instead of the red. This action will grant you the ability to hire one of the units in the market. But you will need to pay the price to be able to get this unit. Once you get this unit, you can use it and you can use their special abilities and can use these ones to fight. When you battle, you can use a lot of different units. There's a lot of cool and unique units in this game. Beautiful artwork, beautiful colors, and a lot of different choices for you to use and to explore. If we look at our castle, we can see that we have three more actions. We can choose to study magic if we have a mage. We can choose to build, or we can choose to attack. If we choose the attack action down here, we need to choose which units we would like to fight with by moving them slightly up a bit. If we have any magic spells, these ones should be calculated in right now. The defender will do the same thing, but they will start to defending their castle. Remember I showed you the little square down here where you could put one peasant or one soldier and get extra defense bonuses. The attack is played out during two different phases. First, you will attack the castle, well, the walls and the building itself. And then in the second phase, you will attack the opponent's units instead. If you have a mage in your castle, you can choose to take that mage and put it down here in the magic studdles on your player board. This will grant you the ability to draw the top two spell cards. Take a look at them and secretly decide which one you want to have and keep it. The other one is put at the bottom of your spell deck. But if you instead use your little peasant here to maybe build something, you will get to choose one of the card from the market to pay for using the resources stated up here, and then upgrading your castle with that building. But if you look at the market, you will see a card not quite looking like the others. This one is actually an action that you also can choose to do. These actions are among the building cards. During the round when they are here, you can use them just as any action on the table. There are a lot of different upgrades that you can do to your castle. It will give you different benefits, it will give you defense, it will give you attack, it will give you resources. There's a lot of different things here, and there's also a lot of beautiful artwork in these cards. Like I said, you can get these ones out on the market if you afford to pay for them, but it's quite worth it. In your castle, you also have a force tracker. At the end of every round, you get one force point. But as I showed you before on the train action, you could also get it from doing different actions, getting one point at a time. When you reach number 5, you can use these 5 points to draw a force card. This card should be read out and shown to the other players. Once you draw one card, you should also draw one of these force tokens. These should be placed in the force tracker. There can be a maximum of 5 of these in each game. So if a 6th one is drawn, just ignore it. Now these ones can either be positive or negative, and usually messes up the game pretty bad for you. Once we do not have any more workers or peasants or anything to place out and play actions with anymore, we move into the end of round phase. This is where we clear out the board. We take back our little workers here and we place them in our country yard. We should also do any effect that has an end of round effect on it, and we need to turn around these cards up here, giving us more actions for future turns. Once we flip around the second action card, we need to put a new force token on the force track. When we flip the cards with peasants on them, we get those peasants, one each. Again, when we flip the fourth card at the end of the fourth round, we need to put out another force card. When we flip around the fifth card in the fifth round, we will need to take away all the green outskirt card. And again, when the sixth card is flipped, we again get each one peasant. In this game, you also have solo scenarios where you compete against yourself. So far, there's 5 of them in this book, but there says there are going to be more of them later on. And I have played a few of these actually, and I really, really enjoyed it. I thought it was a lot of fun just trying to beat the other non-playing, the NPC, and trying to get the most scores that I possibly could. This is really, really a cool feature, and there's a lot of gameplay in here. And like I said, there will be more of these. This is awesome. So there you have it, people. That was Kinghill for you, a two or one player game from 45 to 90 minutes of gameplay. And there is a lot of options for you to do in this game. You can battle, you can choose to build your castle, get products, train your men, attack. There's just so many things you can do in this game, and I really, really liked it. I like the colors of the game, I like the artwork, I like the gameplay itself. And I played against another player, but I also played a lot of solo in this game, and it just works out really, really well as well. Even if you're sitting down by yourself and trying to defeat an invisible opponent, it's really a lot of fun. And when you challenge another player, you really, really need to be strategic on where you want to place your workers, what you want to achieve during your gameplay. This game is a lot of fun. I can highly recommend it if you like deck builders, if you like defending your castle, if you like worker placement games. This one is quite cool. Check it out. The link is down in the descriptions, like I said. If you like this video, people, please comment this. Please give me a thumbs up. I really, really love reading your comments. I love to interact with you. It's so much fun. If you like my videos, if you like my channel, please subscribe to it and hang along. There will be a lot more videos in the future, I can assure you. So until next time, people, please take care of each other. Please keep on spreading that board gaming love that I know you all have. Peace out.